We will talk about I4S, Interactive Individual Identification System. And for us also, the interactive part is very important. But we've seen with most of the identification tools that there is some interaction in it. But it's very important for our tool. Who has ever heard of I4S prior to the announcement of this workshop?
Okay,
quite a few. Who has ever worked with I4S?
I have tried.
Okay. So we have four different types of annotation for different features. Which one did you use?
I'm not sure. I just thought it was something dealing with the spots. But yeah, it's so many years before.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
I sent you some feedback.
No, that's okay. and you? You used?
Mainly I3S Classic.
Classic.
So spots.
Okay. I will mention them briefly in a few minutes. So we have four different types of annotating for different flavors, as you can say. Jurgen and I, we're not connected to any university or company. We do this just because we can, because we care, because we love to do this. So we do this in our free time. We are entrepreneurs, so we have time to do that. So you all do field work, mainly with a camera or maybe a video camera. Then you do photo identification using a tool, and maybe add some more notes that maybe you can put in discovery. And then finally, you can really do some interesting stuff. You can do the goal of your research. And so we will focus on the photo identification using our tool. But more generally speaking, you collect data, you enrich your data, with identification or maybe metadata like sex or this female is pregnant at the moment, and then you get information, because and with the information you can start making models, looking for migration patterns, things like that, and then you gain your knowledge. And as Chuck said it nicely yesterday, here you can find out who, where, when, and here you can try to gain information about what and why. So we are focusing in this talk about photo identification, but it's very important that you realize what your goal is, and your goal is to gain knowledge. And you should not use photo identification as a goal itself. We think, we strongly believe, photo identification is essential. It should be done properly, it should be done carefully, and you should put a little bit time into that, but it's only facilitating the crucial step of the full research process. And as we've seen, there are multiple systems available, and it depends very much on your species, your animal, and also on the circumstances. So in this talk, I will briefly go through some of the aspects of the animal features and circumstances you can come across, which has led to our design philosophy of I4S. I will show you a little bit about the four different algorithms, the four flavors, so to speak, and tell you about what we think are the practical limitations and advantages of our tool. It's just an identification tool. Then Jurgen will give you a short demo of I4S and will talk more about the context of photo identification in I4S. So we've seen there are many different features like dots and stripes and rings and all kind of patterns, and that's one thing you have to take into account when you choose a photo identification tool. But also you have to take into account, is it on land, is it in the water, there are different circumstances, is it nearby and can you use this kind of camera, or is it far away, you have to use a zooming lens, or do you maybe lose resolution. Is the region of interest, the body part, is it rigid or is it very flexible? So that maybe on that part you have to decide which kind of identification tool you have to use. Is it a fast moving animal, or maybe is it posing for you? What kind of angle do you have from your photos? Is it on a fixed camera, a fixed point, like the game cameras, or can you choose the angle? How about light? If you have sunlight, you might think that's very nice, but you can have very sharp shadows. But also in the water, if you go deeper, the light diminishes. The red color is getting filtered out, so you have to take all those kinds of things into account. Maybe you have a lot of hitchhikers usually, so which kind of program can deal with that? Maybe in the water it's very murky, you have a lot of little particles that will be between you and the animal. Especially if you use a flashlight, that all those particles will light up, will make it very difficult for an automatic system to identify. You get a lot of reflection if you use a flashlight on land as well. That's hard. And even if you don't have a flashlight, but the animal is swimming close to the surface, you can have reflections from the sun. And we, with our visual system, eyes and brains, we know this is reflection from the sun. But how does a tool deal with that? So there are many, many things you have to take into account before you can choose your tool. And again, you have to take to think about what is my main goal? What do I want to do? And what is the goal of photo identification? What's the bigger goal? So for wildlife photo identification, where you have so many different animal features and so many circumstances, we think that the user should always be in control. And this means that I3S ranks your the animal against the database with known animals, but you as the user makes the match in the end. And the other thing in the design philosophy is that spend a little bit of time in the beginning to annotate carefully. Annotation in I3S is between 30 and 60 seconds per image, roughly. So there's not a lot of time, but spend some time doing that carefully and you get much better results. If you put garbage in, you get garbage out. The other thing is I3S is simple in the way that we don't have many assumptions. We don't use models and things like that. The only assumption we make that an image, a photograph, is 2D. So it's flat. And we have four different types of annotation that's sort of historically prone, but also because there are different features. But they have similar ways of annotation. So the first one we now call I3S Classic was made for animals with regular dot-shaped pattern. This is a ragged-tooth shark from South Africa. You can see all the different dots, and they are a unique pattern for these animals. In I3S, you first mark three reference points, preferably in a nice triangle, which makes this is used for the first rough matching. So you have a 2D image and there's another image you have to rotate and translate. That's the first step. So marking those three reference points carefully is important, and also the sequence of marking it is important. And then you just point out the center of the dots. And basically that's all the annotation you have to do for I3S Classic. Jurgen will show you in the demo more things about it, but just wanted to show this is a very different condition. The color is greenish, it's more difficult to see all the patterns, but it immediately was the first in ranking when we try to match the animal. This is, I think, 6 months in between. And we know for sure it's the same animal because this animal has a wound on the dorsal fin. And it's here again. But this is no problem for arthritis. It started with a raggedy shark. That was the project we did. But soon, lots of people who work with whale sharks use the program as well. They have also nice regular dots, and I think it's still much used for this kind of research. Then the next step, the more logical step, was to extend this type of annotation. For example, the manta, they have nice spots, but they also have these patches. You cannot use a single spot in the center to mark that spot. So we enhanced the program, and now you can, with spot, you can annotate ellipses. So you can give a size and a direction, and then you can do the matching. It didn't work that well for mantas, I think, and I believe one of the problems is that the wings are very flexible, so they bend, and also it's hard to make a nice image like this. This one has a nice angle towards the line of sight, but it's harder. So, but it has been used a lot for the Hong Kong newt. This is a belly of the newt. It's placed on a glass plate, and they can. It's quite a controlled environment. They can control light, etc. So they've used this version, this annotation type, a lot successfully in Hong Kong. The third annotation type is the latest one we made, is for more irregular patterns. Again, you point out 3 reference points, just for the first rough matching. But then you point out the area that's of interest and the area that is almost perpendicular to your line of sight, so not on the head, but flat. And then automatically, typical features are extracted by the program, and then a matching will be made with the known animals in the database. And the last one, this is a little bit different, that we use for contour of flukes. That's quite simple. You also mark a few specific spots, and the contour of the fluke will be extracted automatically. It has been used very successfully with data from the Pacific Whale Foundation, near Hawaii, but they don't have snow, they don't have storm. And they have asked us to, if it's possible to make a combination of this algorithm, the contour extraction, and the pattern, so the previous one. So you can also look at the spots of the flukes. So this briefly the 4 different annotation types. Limitations of our tool is that the angle to the line of sight of your region of interest should not be more than about 40 degrees. And because we don't use any models, the region of interest should be more or less rigid, so not a lot of curvature, because that distorts the image, the pattern. I think that's easily demonstrated to you. Actually, I think this is typical Dutch. People used to place it near the window in the winter when there was a lot of draft. So anyway, I can use it now. This is a nice pattern, as you can see. And if you look at one of these patterns, you can see easily that if you turn it, and the angle to the line of sight is more than 40 degrees or something like that, the pattern will be much distorted. for the people watching. Yeah? And the same for bending. Look at the pattern, and if you bend the body, the pattern will be very much distorted. So, it's just a quick demonstration. So, the advantages of our tool, as we think they are, it's not a species-specific tool, it's just feature-specific. And we don't use much, we don't use any assumptions, just that it's a 2D image that you're using. The only feedback that we did get is that it's easy to use and it's quite quick. It's standalone, so you can bring it to your field work along on your boat or to the open field. It's standalone, so that's easy if you have your database on your laptop. It's free to use, but I think most of the packages are free because otherwise nobody would be interested if it's a commercial package. And it's open source and we provide support. And Jurgen will tell a little bit more about that. Jurgen will show you now a demo now, but we have some tutorial videos placed on YouTube channel, so if you need some more instruction how to get started with I3S, go to our website and there's a link to YouTube. There for all different flavors there's some videos, and this work would not have been possible without some grants of Save Our Seas Foundation, Project Aware and the Indian Oceans Committee.
Okay, I'm going to do something very dangerous with a live audience of the entire world. I'm going to give live demonstrations. Installed software yesterday. And let's start with I3S pattern. Well, it should be readable. I'm not going to tell all about features. Some features of I3S, because those are specific requests, are important. First version of I3S, just one database, that was your data, and that's about it. Soon people started to have to collect data from multiple sites, which did not exchange animals. So they asked for multiple databases. So I3S covers that. It's quite easy to have 10, 20, 100 databases simultaneously. Other aspect, which is what we do, it's quite easy to add your own metadata structure. Not as elaborate as the previous talk, but metadata which is relevant for searching. For example, if you know if an animal is male or female, you can easily half your database you only have to look at half of your database, and perhaps there are many other features. So, if you look here, you can, I'm not going to show it, but it's quite easy to customize it to your own needs. And another aspect, I'm going to come back to that later, it allows for batch compare to cross-examine two separate databases to see where there are overlaps. Now, let's do something interesting. The unknown turtle. So, first, we zoom a bit in. It's taken from a distance. It asks us first to point out beak edge as the first reference point. Well, that one is here. I zoom a bit more. It asks to point out the inner edge of the eye area. Well, that perhaps I offend all kinds of biologists, and it's not a proper name, but that's how we name we used. And third, outer edge of the scales here. Next. Just just click in the area, and if you close the area, 50 points are extracted. It's, say, SIFT-based, however, without the SIFT features, because we found out they simply do not work on the water. It's really got only garbage. So basically what I use are the location of the SIFT key points and the size. Above water, you could use SIFT features, but we didn't succeed. Next, get the search area. As you can see here, you can select on no, give me only the left or the right view. Compare only against the males. Well, tail lengths and size are just bogus. Just to show you can do it. For now, I will compare against the entire database. As you see, it's quite quick. Not that many in, but and next, no, it's a little bit. Select the top. You do a visual comparison. For example, here and here. And as you can see, it should be visible. There's some dark inner darker area, and that's well, not. It's quite on the laptop you can see, but it's quite similar to the one here. Next, you can decide, well, okay, I've made a match, I want to add it to the database, or if you have gone through your database, you can decide, well, it's a new individual, or you just can just identify it. Leave it at that. Another one I would like to show you, it's where that's not. No, let's see where that looks. This is a quite typical underwater photo. So, this is, in my opinion, where automatic tools will really run into problems. You have all this stuff in the water, it's in nighttime conditions, so flash is used. So I think, I did run some experiments with pattern on this type, on these animals, but there were obviously, it worked to some extent, but they were obviously much poorer. So that's, how much time do we have left? Okay. Let's see. Again? No. First dorsal, second dorsal, pelvic, and then as a human, you really have to look what are the spots, what is relevant, and what is not. But as you can see, it's not, I hope it's visible on the screen here. This one, not too far outside the area, not for example at the tail, especially when because the tail is floppy, not too far to the front, but about here, should it work? And as you can see, well, we know this is Vicky. This is a shark we personally met, but Vicky is 2/3, 1/4, and after that, the other sharks come up. That's for the quick demo. I would like to discuss start it right from here. Should I go back? Let's see where, yeah. So another aspect I would like to discuss with you is the accuracy. For accuracy, you need proper databases. And this really took us a while to get proper databases. With proper databases, I mean enough data, enough individuals, and enough photos, multiple photos per animal, preferably 3, 4, or 5. That's quite rare for us. Another aspect is we can annotate it, but hey, we're the experts. We know how this tool works. No, users should annotate it. All three databases were annotated by users. So the first data, in fact, we used to develop the entire system came from South Africa. Those are the Ragatou sharks. 219 individuals, 739 images in total, just to give a general idea. Whale sharks and the Hong Kong newts are our largest databases, say 1,900 individuals, over 2,000 images. Interesting thing I would like to discuss, and I also heard that this is the same for other systems. The more data you use in your database to search for a new image, the better the result will be. For example, if you want use one reference image, you get about, well, depending on the quality of the data, but for the whale sharks, for example, it's about 90% in the top 10. However, if you add just one extra reference image, it dramatically increases, right? In the 90s, and for example, for a third reference image for the whale sharks, it almost goes to 96%. Another interesting fact is, especially with the Hong Kong newts database, we could test that. What happens if your database is 400 individuals? What happens if it's 800 individuals? You expect if I have 2 million newts and I add and compare one against that entire database, possibility is that other newts, which are not the proper one, are on top, increases. It has some effect, but it's relatively mild. Really didn't see nothing to worry, so to say. Another interesting one, okay, but when it is not in the top 10 or it's way down below, what is the reason for that? Well, we did it. It's quite a labor-intensive job, but we did it for the whale shark database, and well, as you can expect, large angle, poor photo quality, photos taken from distance, that has about half of the errors, but the other half were human annotation errors. For example, insufficient spots or spots in the wrong area. Sometimes, the reference points for us are critical, and if you swap them, that really messes things up. You cannot recover from that until you correct that. And sometimes just bad file management. Animals were not named properly. For example, in the whale shark database, they should annotate the entire area. They only did this small bunch, but adding the extra 5 here really increased the performance on this individual. So, important aspect is...
Excuse me, can I just interrupt for a moment? Are we talking about mismatches? Are we talking about incorrectly matched? Or are we talking about matches that weren't in the...
Mismatches is not... that implies that E3S decides it's a match. We rank the database. We just... So, this is the... For example, we talk about the images which are not in the top 5 or top 10, but way down below.
Falsely rejected.
Falsely rejected, but no, a low rank, I prefer. As again, rejection implies that right. I3S decides. So that's... So, how does I3S compare to other tools? The only honest answer is, we don't know. We really don't know. To say something about I3S or Hotspot or what else is the best or if you would like that for your specific animal, you need the same data sets and the same method to evaluate. Perhaps another interesting thing to discuss this afternoon, could we try to get significant data sets in the public domain so we can see where several tools perform best and other tools perhaps not. So people, new users can decide, well, perhaps I should go for my data to this tool. But what I expect the most likely outcome will be completely depending on your type of animal or the circumstances. If you have the really dark murky waters of South Africa, perhaps manual annotation is better, and in other cases, hotspotter or extract compare or whatever is better. However, accuracy is not the only thing I think you should take into account when to choose a tool. Well, first is, I have some features I would like to use for identification. Can a tool handle it? One of the most surprising for us, we didn't expect that one, which came along, are gecko irises, which is, irises are used for human identification, so why not for geckos? But as you can see, it has quite a wild pattern, so how can you annotate it? Can it handle your circumstances? Well, we discussed this before. It really depends, is it in the dark, is it in the light, underwater, above water, you name it. But it has an effect. You can bet it has an effect. Another, for example, in the whale sharks, there are several groups all over the world. And within those groups, for example, at the Seychelles, about 4 or 5 people are annotating the data. Well, but can they do it consistently? If not, you're in for a surprise. Related to that, is it sufficiently user-friendly? Can your people work with the tool? Okay, accuracy is obviously an important aspect. Other ones, metadata. As I said, if you know it's a male, female, you can half the database you're looking into. So, can you use that kind of data in a tool? Open source, is it important? Well, it depends. If you're going for a long-term program of, say, 20 years, you can bet that the Windows version we're using now, where it's compiled for, is not working in 20 years. Perhaps our plane goes down, so, and then you're stuck with a tool, your long-term program, and slowly it starts falling apart. With open source, if you have a smart student, he or she can perhaps get it working again. Same for support. Often, if things don't work, is there someone to email, to call for help? Standalone, if you're going to on a field trip and you want to do identification there, yeah, you just have basically your tablet, your laptop, can it work on that? All aspects, and I don't suggest that this is complete. Perhaps we can extend this list later on of all the important aspects. So, the single most asked question to us by email is, I have blah blah blah, will it work with I3S? Now, the first answer is, please send us some data. I don't know if someone has an obscure animal from New Guinea, if it's going to work with I3S, please send us some typical data you're using. After that, basically, we help the user with this. First is, well, it seems like a trivial question, but we really got people, well, I don't know if I can, if these are separate individuals, but can you? Can I3S tell us?
No.
Don't start with that. Next question is, yes? Okay, we ask, just to get the indication, people are always starting, they don't have enormous databases. We have, say, 30 individuals, two photos of the same area, very important, and taken on different occasions. So not 10 seconds apart, and that also happened. Circumstances are completely identical, so that's basically the same photo. If the answer is no, okay, perhaps start to collect some data first. You get an idea how much the photos will be similar. What kind of trouble do you run into? Next question: can you annotate it consistently? In case of no, well, either this tool is not working for you, or perhaps you should change your data collection. That can also make a difference. And sometimes it's not that much you need to change. I'll come into that later. Yes? Okay, evaluate. I3S, the latest version of I3S, comes with a built-in evaluation. Exactly how it works, that goes a bit too far. But I3S can tell you how good it is, or bad, for that matter, on your own data. Evaluate and say if 95% of your results in top 5, okay, that looks promising, proceed. If you have a much larger database, this is just a rough estimate, or say 30 individuals, two photos, but this gives some identification. If with a small database you don't get this, just skip, and again, consider other tool or change your data collection. If it works, okay, continue, but keep testing constantly. Just make sure the tool is doing what you expect to. So, as I said, sometimes you need to change, for example, data collection. So what can you do to change? What can you do to optimize? First, always keep your original images. Very often we got all the data where people reduced resolution just to make sure that they ran out of storage, but it's really a pain. Specifically if you're using automatic tools, you can always reduce it later on, but please keep all your original files. In case of I3S, it's specifically important, but I think most tools will benefit from it. Make a real effort to take a photo of the same area and from a perpendicular line of sight. So in this case, if the turtle is already out of the water, please step a bit to the left and make sure it's a perpendicular photo. Shield your subjects from direct sunlight or use an indirect flash if you have to, because it's dark. Just prevent reflection. Sometimes it can be quite easy. Again, a turtle, flash was quite strong on the animal itself. Try to shield it. Less shadows, more information, less highlights. If applicable, use a rig to standardize. Optionally, it's not possible for a lynx. However, for a sweet Hong Kong newt, it's quite simple. Glass plate, belly on the plate, camera below, controlled light conditions, much better images. And usually it's the students who do the annotation, but please make sure they're properly trained. For example, this is in the Seychelles. This is the test whale shark. So people go down to make photos, and then they judge whether this is a proper photo. It is a method, and it apparently it works. Most important, involve us. Usually we heard from I3S, and we estimate, don't know for sure, but about 3,200 users worldwide, tens of species, but we really don't know. Please give us feedback. It's nice to hear that it works and it's great and we're so happy. Even if it doesn't work, it's more important. And we rarely hear that. That really helps us. That's the only way we can improve. So we rarely get requests for improvement. And to illustrate why this was, why there was room for improvement, two examples. The first is Katie. Katie, we met at the Maldives. She had been doing a cross comparison between multiple whale shark databases to see whether they could find migration patterns. So she spent most of the summer comparing manually databases, 800, 500 individuals, and seeing whether she could find an overlap. So she did that for an entire summer, and the first reaction when she told us was, why didn't you tell us? We could have automated this for you in 2 days' work. She kept silent, but she was thinking some four-letter profanities. I'm broadcast, I will go into that. But really, it's often that simple. First thing we did in the new release of I3S, this batch compare, so we do a cross comparison. It just outputs an Excel file, and you can sort it on best matches first, and you can see where is the overlap between databases. The next, which also could have been quite simple, iris image from the same gecko I showed before. And basically what was done, I3S Classic was used, and well, these thick blobs were annotated, vertices where there are multiple lines coming together, and endpoints were annotated. I don't know whether this is the best approach for iris images, but an article was published and it worked. But again, I3S Classic has only one type of spot. Here he used